cast down, but not destroyed. There are times I don't understand, but I believe it's turning around for me. I've had struggles and disappointment. There are times I felt so alone. Some of my friends, they let me down, but I still believe it's turning around for me, around for me, around for me, around for me, it's turning around.
Just say it into the atmosphere.
Around for me. Around for me.
It's turning around.
It's turning around for me.
'Cause I can see the breaking.
I can see the breaking of day.
God is
making a way. A change is coming for me.
If I stay strong.
If I stand strong and believe,
there's no reason to doubt.
Reason to doubt.
I know he's working it.
Know he's working it out.
And it's turning around.
It's turning around for me.
Amen, amen. It's turning around for me. You're listening to Boston Praise Radio and TV, and we are in the fifth day of our conference, asking the question in the community, where are the guns coming from? If you're watching us right now on Ustream, I'm going to quickly give out the number to the studio if you'd like to call in with a question or comment. 617-282-0685 is the number to call. Again, 617-282-0685 is the number here live at the studio at Boston Praise Radio. I'm your host tonight, Brother Mark Stallworth, filling in for Pastor Bruce Wall, who is somewhere close by, actually in the role of executive producer tonight and overseeing. But my guests tonight, as they are still coming in, are some very powerful people in the community. And I say powerful because they are role models, they are pastors, they are mentors, they are people that are living the experience. Because we all week long, we've been asking the question, where do the guns come from? But tonight, it's the spin on tonight is who these guns are affecting. And I have a panel that is coming in tonight, and you're going to hear some stories of individuals and what they're going through as a result of the illegal guns in our neighborhood. I have pastors Ronald and Kim Odom, or Kim and Ronald Odom. I'll go back and forth. That way y'all don't get mad at me. You know what I'm saying? Praise God for having you with us tonight. Yeah. And we also have Sister Mary Ann Berryman, one of the members from Legacy Lives On, with us tonight. And we are going to be sharing some of our stories and what is going on in our community. Now, you all actually just got back from Washington, D.C., or a couple, well,
it's been a little over a month,
Y'all just got back, okay. I just first want to just start in before I, you know, blend in. How was it? I mean, what was your thoughts as to going down there and just, you know, what was the feeling that you got as far as this issue being handled?
I'll let you be first. You can be first.
As we prepared to go down, well, we were invited as survivors of victims of gun homicide by the Mayors Against Illegal Guns organization. They had planned a 2-day survivor lobbying day on the Hill, And they paid for, you know, survivors to come down and participate and be a part and talk to our senators and our representatives. And in the interim of the plan to go down, I also was invited by Senator Elizabeth Warren to be her guest to attend the President's State of the Union address. So it was, you know, really I'm using the word exciting. When I say exciting, it was, you know, inspiring to have been asked to represent on behalf of our community. Mm-hmm. Because as you said in the beginning, we represent the faces. Amen. Of those who the violence is impacting. And it's been very important to us to be at the table, to be at the table. So going down there and sitting with our senators and most, all of our, I should say most, but all of our senators and our representatives support the proposals for the gun safety measures. Those, the main three that are being pushed is the universal background checks on all gun sales, banning assault weapons and high capacity magazines, and making gun trafficking a federal crime. So all of those our representatives do support, but it was important. It showed how important it was for us to be engaged in the process. And so I think it made us feel good that we were there, made us feel good to be acknowledged, mm-hmm. and that our loved ones' lives right. were being acknowledged, you
right,
know.
Right.
You know, when I think about, you know, being at this point, and I think about even being there, I think about my son, Stephen. Stephen himself wrote in his peace journal that it's a shame that people get shot and killed every day. And so Stephen's words really move me,
amen,
move
amen.
Us.
Yes.
As we you know, find ourselves being positioned in certain places. So.
And for those of you who don't know, how long has it been for your son now?
So it's been 5 years, a little over 5 years. His life was taken October 4th, 2007.
I want to go over to Pastor Ronald now.
Yes.
I you know, and it was a beautiful thing that you went down there. One of the things that I feel that got overlooked, kind of, and this is my own thought because somebody said it to me, and I want your opinion on this. Okay, so in our community, when they need money, like, you know, they're talking about going up on the gas tax and the cigarettes, and why can't they charge more for the ammo? I mean, really, who needs, you understand what I'm saying?
Sure.
I mean, no, really, I mean, make it hard to get.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's not, I mean, like you said, the background checks and all of that, but there's still another point because you always have that, quote unquote, the black market.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that the ammo and the guns should be harder to accomplish, to get, to be mm-hmm. able to get in the hands. Because when you look in our community, there is not a Smith & Wesson factory around
right,
here.
Right.
There's not a Colt 45 mm-hmm. factory around here.
Mm-hmm.
There's definitely not employing anybody around
mm-hmm.
here. But yet, it's taking the most toll right here in our neighborhoods.
Right.
You know, we lose more per day in the States than we do in combat.
Sure.
Because of this going on. What do you, how do you feel?
First, I just thank the Lord for being here today. I
Amen.
thank
Amen.
God for you giving this the opportunity to be here on today, and all the guests that are here today. We're certainly grateful to those that are even listening in to the broadcast. I believe this is of great importance that we bring this to the forefront. Just as important as what's going on in Washington, I think we should take the same charge, if you will, to bring this to the forefront, that what's going on in our community. So I thank the staff and everybody here that is making this possible, that we're able to have this forum today. And my wife has shared, you know, the whole trip to Washington was a great, just to be considered to be at the table was an honor, I believe, because we everything that we do concerning this, it concerns our son, and not only our son, but all the sons in the community, and the sons and the daughters. We've found out that it's bigger than just Stephen Odom. It's for the Stevens and even the Stephanies of our community. So just as much attention that Washington is getting concerning what's going on in the mass shootings, I believe that I thank God for this forum that we're able to bring our story also to the forefront. We may not be as large as everyone, you know, every other, but
our bite is just as big.
I thank God for the opportunity and the outlet. Now, as far as the ammunition, the question that you proposed to me, and it is true that this question that we always will ask, where did the guns come from?
Amen.
I believe that we may not be able to answer that question.
True.
But one question we can answer, which you already said, they're not coming. I know I can answer this question, that they're not coming from Dorchester. The guns are not coming from Roxbury. They're not coming from Mattapan. Right. They're not coming from the urban communities in the areas. We know that for sure. Like you said, there's not a Smith & Wesson. The closest one is further up there near Springfield somewhere, Indian Orchard around that area. So we know where they're not coming from.
Right, right.
And to put a tax or to put a higher cost on ammunition, you know, there's still people that's going to find a way to get to what they need to get to, you know, whatever the cost. People are spending money on things that they think that are value. So I believe if the stake is higher, they're going to find people that really want to find ammunition. They're going to pay all whatever it takes to get. I just believe that.
Amen, amen. We also have my extended family, Legacy Lives On, is in the house. We usually have our group meetings tonight, and tonight I invited them to actually have the meeting here at the studio. And we meet every Thursday, and we have Sister Marianne Berryman, we have Sister Clarissa Turner, we have my other two sisters, Miss Faye Rackley in the back, and Sister Collars in the back, and you know, we want to say hello, and we're going to have you come in, jump in, and swap out in a minute, just a few. But I want to go to Sister Marianne right now, and just because I look at, when I see what's in the room right now, again, I said at the earlier part of the broadcast, I see strength, mm-hmm. I see mentors, I see hope in our community when I see you all in this room. We're here for the same purpose. Right. This is where we live. This is where we pay our taxes. A lot of us have to drive by these locations all the time. Right. And to see you all here in strength and in numbers that we are, just tells me that, like you said, we might not have an answer, but there is something we can do, and we can come together and we make our voices loud. The dog might not be big, but the bite is what we going after.
That's
right,
my driving. That's what's driving me.
Amen.
Even,
and
you know, even if, and I don't mean to cut in.
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
Even if, as my husband said, people are going to find a way, but you still don't quit trying to make it harder. For the, you know, you still don't stop from trying to strengthen the you know, the measures.
Sure,
to, the measures, to shore
right,
up
right,
the gap.
Right, sure, right, yeah. Right.
We still have to do that. We still have to make it harder for people to access firearms, to access that ammunition. It just baffles the mind, however, that that there's such weaponry. You know, out there civilians,
right,
to be able to get their hands on that. Like, you know, people, you know, say, well, it's for hunting.
Who needs to hunt?
Right, with a semi-automatic rifle. Exactly. I mean, come on, my grandparents, I mean, I, you know, 30-06 if I'm calling it right. Yeah. You know, one shot, you look through the scope and that's it. But that's what I'm seeing on TV right now, you're talking urban warfare.
Right.
I mean, really, this is, it's not acceptable.
So we have a responsibility as parents to address issues that our children's lives are exposed to when it concerns that's jeopardizing their lives. When we become aware that there's something out there that's dangerous, that there's these loopholes that expose our children to, because the children are the ones, unfortunately, that are most vulnerable, who are getting caught in the middle of this.
Right.
And it's about greed and power when you really, when you look at it, because it's about profit, people making money,
right?
It's about people making money. So, and we have a responsibility to address those laws that are in place or that aren't in place that should be protecting public safety.
You know, I want to shift gears a little bit, because one thing I see when I see you and your husband is I see strength. Mm. And through it all, you all have managed to stay. A lot of families have split up when something like this affects them. And I wanted to ask you, what would you say, or what word might you have of encouragement for families that are going through? And I also want to give a shout out to GMAT Radio in Chicago. I heard Elder Strada's testimony about how he lost his son, and his wife is still, him and his wife are still together. But, you know, in a lot of cases, you know, the parents split up because they can't take the, you know, they can't find a way to be there for one another. I want to ask you, how does it work for you all?
I always share that I need my wife.
Amen.
The family structure, and that I believe that God has instituted the whole family. It's important today. People need to see the family value. The family has value, and we understand that there will be things that will try to get in and divide the force, because we know that, and we come to understand we're two people pulling together for the same purpose. You're a force to be reckoned with, whether it's good or bad. That has been demonstrated even in, as far as the bad go, in the Columbine incident. Two people with singleness of mind pulled a trigger and got national attention.
Right.
That's
right.
For evil.
Right.
Now, can we imagine with two people pulling together for the same purpose, you're still a force to be reckoned with? So I told, you know, after this tragedy of our life, I need my wife. I need her. I know statistics have said everything. You mean to tell me for me to run into somebody else's arms with that? Would that make things better?
Right,
I still
right.
would be a father that have lost a child.
Amen.
So I'm determined to whatever it take to keep the, because I know that there's gonna, I know that God has us together for a purpose. You know, we're 30 strong?
30 plus
strong, and then where can I go anywhere?
Right.
Well, I'm sure there are some places.
I can't go nowhere.
And somebody would.
Nobody want me.
My piece to that is, you know, I acknowledge also understanding how the pressures of a tragedy can cause
a
division.
Amen.
Because as much as we are determined to stay together, there were some moments that tried us.
Amen.
And one in particular I share, the gravestone.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't want to put a gravestone at Stephen's site, the grave site, until they found Stephen's killer.
I needed to know.
And I couldn't comprehend that. I felt like Stephen's being punished again. You know, his life is being dishonored again. This person who took his life is controlling things. The way murders are being solved in our neck of the woods, they might not ever find the murderer, and Stephen would never get ahead. That's how I was feeling.
Amen. Amen.
And I just couldn't comprehend that. And he said he didn't want it to happen till someone found it. And I just was like, oh no, people are going up to the gravesite and there needs to be something there that says Stephen was here. Stephen existed. His life, people love him. So
she went on and did it.
And bought it anyways. But we have laughed a little about that. But that could have been something that could have really split
Amen.
Us up.
Amen.
You know what
Amen.
I'm saying?
Yes,
because
I
the enemy will come in and try to use just something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Something to tear us apart. And I did. And we got through that.
Yeah. Amen.
You know, but then I had to learn. We had to learn how to respect each other's process,
right,
grieving
right,
process,
right,
because
right.
You know, I was at a different place than he was at a particular time, you know, and so we've learned and we're still learning how to respect each other in our process.
Amen. Amen. So it's the melding of two processes and finding a common ground that keeps you all so strong, because I still see the strength and the love when I see you all together. I first met you all at, I heard the name, I've heard the name, I've walked by your church many times, but it wasn't for Clarissa's event that when you all came and spoke that I actually met
Beautiful
you all,
event.
But I saw something very strong there, and I'm so glad that we had this time. And I wanna, how you feeling tonight, my sister? You feeling all right? Yeah, I wanna, you know, because tonight's focus is, how the illegal guns are affecting those people in our community who are law-abiding, paying their taxes, and whose children have been
trained
right to fall in this, that have fallen in this community. And I want to shift gears to Sister Clarissa, because right now your dimension of this is that they've caught your son's killers and you are now going through the court process. And I want to give you a chance to just speak a little bit on how you feel and what you're going through and how the enemy's trying to get you off of your game. And you introduce yourself, tell everybody what, you know, who you represent.
I'm Clarissa Turner. I'm so sorry.
That's all right. That's all right. She don't like the headphones. She likes to just do her
okay.
thing. So you and, you flow with it, sis.
My son is Willie Marquise Turner. He was killed in November 2011. I just want to go back and give honor to God.
Amen.
Pastor Odom.
God bless you.
Mary Ann.
We didn't pray in, but we're going to pray out. Believe me. I got
Carla.
It.
Like I said, my son was killed back in 2011. And nobody but God, you know, saw me through. And just to go back, Kim Odom, she was one of the that I spoke with when I lost my son, and she was such a great support. So when you speak about, you know, what you all went through, and then for you all to be there for someone else who just going through, I thank God, and I always let her know she is definitely my inspiration as a woman that just lost her son, and just being able to give herself. What was your question again? I'm sorry, I got so caught up.
I just wanted you to, you know, to give your, you know, your what you're going through right now, because obviously you're a single mom, and and you're carrying your whole family right now, as well as carrying yourself.
Yes.
And again, tonight's focus is, you know, what is the fallout? Who are these guns affecting in our community? It's one thing to keep asking the question, but tonight's conference, part of the conference, is how these guns are affecting the families in our community. Everyone at this table has a story, and I want to give everybody a platform to talk about and share, if they're up for it, you know, how these guns are affecting us in this community. You understand? So we know recently that you had told us that they caught your son's killers, and now you're going through the court process. And I wanted you just to elaborate a little bit on that and how you feel, what your experience is and what you're going through.
The experience of losing my son was and has been a long journey. After losing my son, my mom passed. So there's a lot of missing gaps. And the same week that my mom passed, that's when I was told that they caught the two young men who took my son's life. To have to go to court and see these young men, and they are now, I mean, they are in incarcerated, but these are somebody else's children. Mm-hmm. Being able to sit there, and I'm seeing a mother, and she's looking at her son who's accused of taking my son's life. And it was so odd because he kept on looking back. And every time he looked back, we was locking eyes. So this young man don't even know that I am the mother of the person's life he took. So I'm sitting there and I'm looking into this man's eyes, and I can't really express what all I was going through. It was hurt, it was anger, pain. Mm-hmm. And I'm looking at him like, this is somebody's child. You know what I'm saying?
Right, right.
And I pray every day of my life that one day I can honestly say I forgive. Mm-hmm. I'm not there yet. And I'm going to be honest, I'm not there yet. But I pray, because I don't want to ever hold no evil, no hate in my heart. Every day is a struggle, because I'm finding myself going to court every month as they get ready for his trial. And I can only imagine how hard it's going to be to hear in details everything. Mm-hmm. When I go to court now, it's hard.
And you being the matriarch of your family, I you know, I thank you for your giving your testimony today. But again, you know, we have to, you know, it's because the media only covers so much. You know, once the crime tape is gone, we still have to live. You know, we still have to go on. And this is the part that I want to focus on. And, you know, it like you said, you know, it not only, you know, did, you know, a mother still lost her son on the other end because he doesn't have those freedoms anymore. And we still have to go on, and we still have to survive in the same communities. And, you know, so my focus has always been, let some people hear from this perspective how you all are now. I mean, you, again, I look at you as mentors and pillars of the community, and role models, you know, just because you're making it, you're getting through. And I want this heard. You know, it's one thing, you know, it's great, we've been asking the question all week, but I felt tonight was really a pivotal night in this conference, because people are hearing from those that are going through and have to continue to go through. And not just day by day, but hour by hour. Right.
And the siblings, when you talk
about, yes, the siblings. I'm looking at my man right there. I want him to come on over here and hang out with me.
Children.
Yes.
Right.
Because
right.
I have six children, and I have five remaining. But my son that's deceased, he's still my baby.
That's
so
right.
I have six kids.
And just to, you know, offshoot off of that, you know, they're going through.
That's right. Every day.
They're going through, and they're looking for you for strength. And you have no place. I mean, you do have a place to look in God and in our Lord and Savior. But I'm just saying, you know, they're looking for you to see what your action is, right, and how they're going to make
it. And your response.
Right. And what your response is, and how you're handling certain situations. And that's where they're drawing from. So
it affects them in school, you know, work, college. Their lives also get at a standstill. And as us being parents, we have to keep our kids, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
On a straight path. And how do you expect children? For example, my children see my son Monday. A couple of hours later, we're being told my son's life was taken. The next time they saw him lying in a casket. Yeah. How do kids process that?
Right.
See, people don't think about all that. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Especially my smaller children. You know, the older kids, they went to the morgue. But my smaller kids, they're asking questions. Where's my keys, Mom? What happened, you know? Because I didn't really want to go into details and tell them. So I tried to tell them what I could. And the next time they saw him, I'm in the casket. And them trying to process that and understand what happened, who did this and why, you know? So
yeah,
I think that people, you know, on the outstretch, people don't know if you don't tell them. But so many times people don't want to hear our sad stories. But this is our reality.
I think they're real stories.
They are real stories.
We've let these guns. Right, right. Yeah,
when
you're right.
When you try to talk to people on the outstretch, sometimes people will say, you know, that's too painful. I don't want to, you know, hear that. But right. we have to deal with it every day of that's our life.
Everyday life.
We can't escape it.
Right.
That's the, you know, we constantly, this is our life. We're living this every day by day, minute by minute. This is not a story. This is not a sitcom or any other thing like that. This is our life. This is not The Wire. And The Wire have taken real life issues and put it on the screen and taken our stories and somebody lining their pockets with our story. Now, you'll see in the stories probably sometimes a person that is playing a role in one episode and probably have lost their life, and you'll probably see them again because they're actors. This is not the movies, man. This is our life.
Amen.
We live in this daily, man. Amen. And that's when I begin to see that, you know, like, show up. I can't watch the show. I can't watch The Wire. I can't watch Law and Order. I can't watch none of them shows.
I can,
you know, because I, like I said, you'll see this actor in one role and lose his life, and then you'll probably see him in some other role.
Yeah, but on a commercial.
In our life, I'm not going to see my son on this side of the earth anymore.
Amen.
And so it's not the movies, man. This is my real life.
Amen.
And that's where the pain began to sink in. You know, I couldn't even walk in my son's door in his room, man, because I know the next day he was ready. Or his clothes or something was set for the next day. It took us, you know, listen, we grew up, we had school clothes and we had play clothes.
Right.
And, you know, this worked in my parents' house and it worked in our house too. Listen, those are your school clothes and these are your play clothes.
Right.
So his school clothes was laid aside and he had changed up, you know. So, and when I see that, it just, you know, breaks my heart. It took us all we can, you know, even to see some of the billboards that was up. One caught us off guard, you know. I wasn't expecting that, but I accepted it. But so this is the only way I see my on a badge.
Right, t-shirt. Right.
A t-shirt.
Right. There's too many street corner memorials. Too many candles on corners. And I want to, how you doing, sis? You okay? You want, because I want you to. Are you up for it? I want to ask you first. I want you to talk about all of it. I want you to introduce yourself.
I'm Carla Sheffield. I'm new to this. My son, it will be a year, August 21st. But I'm angry. Good. I wasn't this angry till I came in here. I mean, I was. My anger comes and goes because, unlike you guys, my son was killed by a police officer. And it was supposed to be a routine traffic stop. They justified it. However they justified it. But me as a mother, I work in the courts. Mm. I gotta wait till they finish putting their stuff together before I can get anything to file charges against the officer who killed my son. I don't even know his name. It's going on a year. I've called the NAACP. I reached out to the community. I reached out to black leaders. Not one person has called me back. I work at the State House for 11 and a half years. I'm in the court for 6 years. It took a meeting that I was not invited to for them to calm the community. A meeting for me to get somebody to call me because Sonya Ching showed up. She didn't know none of this had happened. I called Michael Curry at the NAACP. I cried in his phone. He didn't call me back. I watched the City Views. I watched all the Sunday programs. I watched all the black leaders. Reverend Borders, they gave me the church for my child. Had me change my family's reservations for Friday. When I go sign the paperwork, they tell me to have split service, have his wake on Thursday and his funeral on Friday. How do you do that? Then I walked out to church. I had no church. I literally had to go knocking on church doors to get a place to bury my son.
Amen.
I still have a $3,000 bill for one funeral home. My son doesn't have a marker, so when you was telling that story, I can't put a marker on my son's grave because I have to fight the state that I work for, every lawyer that I talk to, oh, we're gonna take this case. Everybody wants to take it civilly. I don't give a shit about money. That's not gonna bring my son back. I want him to lose his job and go to jail for killing my son. I gave you 2 pages of witnesses. 2 pages that contradict them. There's a girl who was in the hospital that when they were supposed to be having mental distress, she's in another room. She just met my son 3 months prior. Overhears them talking about getting their story together. But I gotta wait a year for y'all to just give me an officer's name? Are you kidding me?
It's definitely not right. And this is, again, you know, not having the proper people that we pay our tax dollars to.
It's not even about the proper people. It's about election, and they're scared to touch it.
Amen.
That's what it is. Because when it was election time, I couldn't get through to nobody. Nobody. If Sonya didn't come there, Martha Coakley's office wouldn't have called me back because I cried to them. I cried to the FBI. Everybody want to point it to another place. And the thing about that is, okay, yeah, we're talking to Martha Coakley's office, but you're still Boston police. How do you investigate yourself?
Right.
How do you investigate? How are you going to come tell me as a Boston police officer, you're a Boston police officer because y'all don't get along in the workforce, that you're going to do the right thing? You're going to do justice. The justice system is becoming a big joke.
Amen.
And I need more than just what they're giving me regarding my son. It was supposed to be a routine traffic stop. You said he had a gun. Everybody says he didn't have a gun. You said you shot him in his chest. Why is there no bullet hole in his chest? Come on. It doesn't take 2 years or rocket science for you all to get this stuff together. It just doesn't. And for me to have to sit here and wait till you all get your game together for me to properly bury my child.
Yeah, it's definitely not fair.
And I'm supposed to take this anger and tuck it away. And then go to work in the district court and tell everybody that they keep putting warrants on that you're going to come back because we don't remove warrants after 2. Like, are you kidding me?
Amen. So, I I'm glad that you spoke up because you've been one of the instrumental people as far as, you know, when you came into Legacy, and we wanted to be there to give you a platform to voice how you feel, because that's part of the process. You need to have your story told.
It's real.
It needs to be heard. It's real.
That's
just
real,
like,
man.
Pastor said, and we're definitely gonna continue to pray with you and for you. And I hope that someone listening right now can offer some support in this matter, because it is dealing with a step above. I mean, you know, one side of the table is dealing with, you know, just ordinary children that are growing up in the streets, but you have to go against the powers that be that run this community.
That
you work with and for, and smile at you in your face during the week.
Go do what you need to do for your son. Don't do it on office time. I work 8 to 4. When the hell else can I do it?
Right, right.
Excuse me.
And if I was to say, Mark, you asked the question of, you know, this is what happens.
Right. This is
the
a result.
Families, our worlds, our lives are never the same. You know what I'm saying? We
absolutely
have to carry this. You know what I'm saying? So this is what happens to us. That pain ongoing. Like I said, nobody but God.
Nobody
and
but
I,
God.
I have to go back to that.
And I seriously believe as a community, all these people that we put in this office, if they don't start doing what we put them in the office to do, we need to vote them out. I'm sick of them sitting up there getting paid for stuff that they're not doing. It's
Amen.
Ridiculous. You got so many seats up in that state house that are filled by people who don't have the degree. So many hungry kids coming out of college who have degrees and they're waiting for jobs because you have lackeys sitting up there collecting pensions. Give me a break. We need to pull together and get them out of there and get our voices heard. And I need to go up in there. I've been there 11 years. I see their tricks. I see their games.
Amen. And that's true. I mean, these are our tax dollars at work. They know where to find us when it's time for the voting to come. But when something really goes down and you tell us you're going to be there for us, I mean, the response is not, it's not, it doesn't even exist. And, you know, for them to even tell you that, I feel like that's wrong, period. You know, the word says no weapon formed against us shall prosper. So we need to get some results, because I definitely want to see you to be able to have some peace You know, and I thank you for your story today. I thank you not for your story, but sharing your life, because it's what you're living hour by hour. And, you know, I, again, want to reach out to anybody out there that may have some information. The number here is 617-282-0685, 617-282-0685. We are on the fifth day of our gun conference, and the question is being asked, where are the illegal guns coming from? The panel today consists of survivors. We're all survivors here at this table today, that, you know, we've all lost loved ones, and it affects all of us,
right?
Because we are one body, and I have to say that as a united church, which is churches in us, from what I understand, that's what my grandmama said, you know. But it's all I you know, I'm holding back my tears right now, because I know where you're coming from when you don't get the answers that you want, and you know that it's not justified.
That's right.
It's not justified, and right. We need to step above and beyond and go outside the box to find whatever resources we can find to find out who there is somebody out there that's bold enough to take this on. Mm-hmm. And we just have to pray that God will bring that person into the light. I want to slide over to Miss Faye Rackley. How you doing, my sister?
Pretty good.
You doing good? I want you to introduce yourself and just tell a little bit of who you are tonight.
Okay, my name is Faye Rackley. I'm a part of Legacy Live On for Murder and Homicide Kids. This week has been a kind of tough week. My grandson, Kenneth Keith Rackley, he was murdered July 25th, 2010. And it has been a struggle. You know, I don't think they realize what the family go through.
Well, I want you to share what you're going through right now.
Oh, it's right now I feel like I want to cry.
Mm-hmm.
Just cry. Mm-hmm. It's like mixed emotions. You know, our kids didn't deserve to be murdered like that. Matter of fact, Miss Odom, your son, my grandson is buried right directly across from your son, Stephen. Mm-hmm. At Christmas time last year, I went up and put little ornaments on each one of the graves when I was up there. And I went to Stephen every time I go there to go to his
grave. Thank you so much.
It's just, I don't know, it's about, you know, I can go up to the house, and as Pastor Odom was saying, to go into the room, it's hard, you know what I mean? Like he was saying about the clothes, and I could be there with my daughter, it's my daughter's son. And prior to Kenneth's murder, my mom had come down with old timers. She was like going out of the house. So I left my house, went to stay with her for like 4 months, you know, because I didn't want her to be put away. I wanted her to have the time she could, you know, there. So I spent the time with her, and it's amazing how every day within that 3 to 4 months, Kenneth was there every day at my mom's house, helping me doing things for her, cooking, just sitting around talking. Maybe it was just meant for us to have that special time. Sundays is really hard because Sundays I would make breakfast, and he would go and lie on the bed, and I'd serve him breakfast in bed. You know, that was just so special. And then prior to my mom had to be placed in a nursing home, we had to clean out the house. Kenneth was there every day, him and all the grandkids, friends. And it was some TVs, and I said, Kenny, you know, you gotta get the TVs and everything out by Friday. And that Friday, I was standing in my doorway, and Kenneth and my son and a couple of friends, they was in a Jeep, they had went over and took the last of the stuff out. And if I had known that was the last time, if I had just known. But it was something about, I stood in a doorway that we locked eyes. For some strange reason, we locked eyes. And we were due to go for a cell phone to get his new cell phone. And he was gonna be going away to college down in Miami with my other granddaughter. And it was just, I don't know. And one thing that happened was really amazing. I was up at Save a Lot. And I walked in the store and I saw these plums, and oh my God, it's just the little things, not the big things. I had to come up to the store and I just broke down. Mm. I had my shades with me, so I put them on. And all of a sudden, you would not believe, on the intercom system, they said, Kenneth, could you come to the front of the store? Mm. And there was a young man that worked in a store named Kenneth, and I said, oh, thank you, God. There is a Kenneth that's walking around here.
Wow.
You know, it was just, I mean, young man, I wanted to just run over and hug him. Mm-hmm. And I just said, thank you, God, you're still, like, you can be at a chick, just little places, you know, just a little thing.
Yes, mm-hmm. Yes.
You know. But you know, as Clarissa was saying, it's God, because if it hadn't been for God, I just, don't know how I would have made it. And it was also, as she was talking about, the tombstone. My family, too, they wanted to wait on the tombstone. And my thing was that I had to have it up before the year was up. I felt that if I didn't make it or I just died with all that was going on, I had to have this tombstone. So I had the tombstone up 3 to 4 weeks before the year. And then it's just like I have to, every holiday, I just have to go there to take flowers or something. Mm-hmm. This past month, with all the snow and everything, I called the grave site up there because I know one of the guys that worked the grave up there, and he was saying not to come up. It was so much snow or whatever. And he said, oh, you know what, Faye? I wiped off his face because I have a picture of him. Mm-hmm. He said, I wiped the snow off his face, so don't worry. I felt good about that.
Amen.
You know, because he said that. But it's tough.
Yes.
I mean, when you walk in that, I remember walked in Boston Medica, and this officer was there that I knew, and my grandkids, my daughter, everybody was losing it. And this officer called me aside. He said, you know what, Faye, because I know him personally, you know, you have to really get yourself together. It's like I pull myself up and say that you're not sure that it's Kenneth, because I mean the grandkids were just going off. And I had to walk to the door, me myself, just to tell them, you know what, I'm not sure if it's Kenneth or not, to calm them down. And all along I knew that he was gone, just to try to keep the family just together for that moment.
Amen. I thank you for that. And again, you know, these testimonies that you're hearing right now are real. These are everyday lives that are being lived right now. And I want to slide over to Sister Mary Ann just real briefly. And, you know, your dimension is, and we've talked about this in the past, you're on a remarkable road to recovery right now. And you live within, I want to say, 100 yards of where you lost your son. And I know you go through that area a lot. And how's it been for you? And introduce yourself. And
my name is Mary Ann Berryman. Oh, I like to say what I've done. It's gone on 11 years that my son was murdered at Son's Pizza. He was shot in his head and twice in his chest on my daughter's birthday, September 9th. 14 days after I buried my mom. My mother died of lung cancer, and I'm a breast cancer survivor 14 years.
Praise God, praise God. So how is it for you?
Well, it's gotten much better, you know, because like I said, me and my kids, we live together now, and he was murdered on my daughter's birthday, so I know I'm quite sure she's going through something too, because it was her birthday, you know, and this month is his birthday, so I've been having little hard times, you know. So I've been keeping myself pretty much busy because his birthday is April 27th, and he'll be 30.
Amen. You know? Amen.
So this month I've just been keeping myself real busy, you know. And then I got my little grandson. I'm really close to him, you know. Almost like I'm trying to substitute, but it's kind of, I'm going up and down, you know, with the feelings and stuff. So I come and go. Mm-hmm. But I have a strong structure thing going on for myself. I have a lot of, you know, therapies and stuff like that, psychiatrists and stuff that I got going on.
Amen. Amen. And I meet with you all on, I meet with you all on every Thursday. And every Thursday, I mean, I feel that my place is with you all. I feel that we are connected. I'm acting in the will of God. And he said, that's where I want you to be. And it was from our first broadcast here. And this is our night. And, you know, God is good, because normally we're chewing and chat and chew. Is that what you say? Is that what you call it? And, you know, and now, you know, the guy usually comes and tells us and gives us that look like we've got to end. But tonight that's not going to happen. But, you know, but it's very encouraging for us, you know, to have this platform. And usually I'm sitting around the table offering scripture and prayer to you all. But tonight this is more of a, you know, giving you a chance to really just elevate and have your stories told, your lives shared. Not just here locally, but worldwide right now, because we know that this is, you know, and you mentioned, you know, the birthday months and around the holidays, how you all are surviving. Just recently, I just want to come back around real quick and just, you know, you mentioned that it's your month. This month is your son's birthday. He'll be 30. Yeah. And I like how you said he'll be 30.
That's right.
And praise God for that, because that, you know, that helps with the process. Miss Faye, how is it for you on the holidays?
Oh, it's really sad, because Kenneth's birthday is October 4th. And but you won't believe it, I try to do a breakfast to have the family and friends all around to celebrate that day for his birthday.
And Carla, I know this is your first year, but I'm going to hit you from a different standpoint, because I see the strength that God is putting in you. When you first came in Legacy, I mean, when you first came to your first meeting, we just, you know, yeah, and you know, I've seen where God has brought you from with my own eyes. And to the point we talked at the last meeting, I wasn't at last week's meeting, but the meeting prior.
Me either. I think that's why I'm emotional. Every
that's
time
right.
I miss a Thursday, I get crazy. I
so you missed last
take
week.
Over. I did. And the devil has just been working its magic on me. Seriously, like.
But the devil's a lie.
That's right.
He is.
The devil is a lie.
He is.
And you know, because a lot of times we talk, we read in the Bible of all the miracles that Jesus did, but I can say that I honestly see it in front of me. When if you had seen this woman on her first meeting with us, to the point that the meeting before she missed, she was actually ministering to someone else now. You understand? And she said, she made a statement, she made a very profound statement that she hadn't cried in over a week. So we knew that that was progress, and we knew what this is about, because, you know, Legacy is not one of these organizations that is looking for grants and all of that. This is real ministry work. It's a conglomerate of other ministries. There's some key people that are not here tonight, because we have different aspects of the ministry. Auntie Nat's Village is doing
she's,
a play
she's
tonight.
Coming.
She's
yeah,
coming.
She's coming.
Beautiful. And you know, and I say this to say that, you know, unfortunately, our children were the starting point of these various conglomerates of ministries coming together. I've heard your names, the Odoms, mentioned, like, you know, really strong in the community. All on, you know, on the point of again, I'm looking at you all as mentors, as role models for other families. You understand, how do they make it through these times? If they can look and see the love and strength, you said you need your wife.
Mm-hmm. I love that.
And that was powerful. That was, I got to tell you, because I have a lot of respect right now for you, because, that's right, give him the pound. Right, because one of the things you're going to see that Legacy, we have men. And that was one of the reasons why I came, to let them know that it's okay to let go.
Oh, yeah.
It's okay to, you know, cry. We can cry a little.
I don't have a problem with that at all.
You understand? And because we have some members that are men. Mm-hmm. And Kyle is usually, her partner is usually with her tonight. I don't know where he is, but he missed out.
He's in time out tonight.
Oh, he's
in the bubble and him. Somebody had to take a back seat, and it wasn't me. So he needs to be there, and I need to be here.
He's in time out.
Amen.
You put him on time out, sis?
Big time.
Okay,
yeah.
All right.
Well, I just want to mention about the holidays, because when my son was killed, I went through it all. Like, my son, his birthday is August 11th. He was my oldest boy. My youngest boy was born on his birthday. Ooh. My son was killed 10 days after he turned 25. So I went through his birthday. Well, didn't go through his birthday. My birthday is November 21st. His anniversary of his death will always fall on my birthday. Thanksgiving, I went through it because this was his first Thanksgiving away from me. Christmas, New Year's, my oldest son's, my middle son's birthday, my daughter's birthday, and now we're going back around the year. I just celebrated my 9-year-old's birthday. She has never not seen her brother. And then we're coming back on to my son's birthday. So I hit every single holiday. Mm-hmm.
It's
and they
hard.
Took him.
Mm. I got to let you know, you got a call. That call I got earlier was directed at you. You have, we call her mother, Reverend Betty Collier. She's praying for you. She wants to get in touch with you. She wants to talk with you. So she's reached out to you. She called me to let me know specifically that she wanted to talk with you. So I'm going to give you her number after this broadcast. And again, you're listening to the fifth day of the Gun Conference here live on Boston Praise Radio and TV. My guests tonight are all survivors. We have Pastors Ronald and Kim Odom, and we have Legacy, the families of Legacy Lives On. I also have another guest that we'll be talking to in a few. I want to thank you all, because this is nothing but God. Right here, this has nothing to do with me. This is nothing but God, because people have to hear it. People have to understand what these guns are doing in our community. I was really appalled. 2 weeks ago, I was getting ready for something at home, and I heard a clip on the news that the families down in Newtown, Connecticut, were getting robocalls from the NRA telling them to support the gun legislation that they don't want to give up. And I thought that was really, but I looked at it from a spiritual standpoint.
Insensitive.
I said the enemy is really, really insensitive. He don't care. For them to get those calls at dinner, sitting around the table, and your phone rings, and it's an automatic recording telling you to support gun legislature after you just lost your child at school in a place that it should have never taken place. I really look at that as an act of the enemy. And what's going on. And I only say that, you know, we have to band together. It is not about this church or that church. We have to band together.
That's right.
And I say this everywhere I go, and I'm not going to cease until I say it. We have over 1,500 churches in the city of Boston. And out of that 1,500, I would say more than one third to almost half are within 100 yards of a park. And we have to take to the streets. We have to shut this thing down. Because we can't, obviously we know they're not going to do it. No. So it's going to be up to us go out here and take over these parks. I know of a man that's in this room that has slept in drug houses and shut them down. I know of a man that has slept out on parks and moved the drug dealers out. And hey, it might sound radical, but Christ was a radical.
That's right.
And these are the measures that we have to take. We can't, listen, I don't feel anybody in this room has nothing to lose right now, because we got God on our side. Mm-hmm. We have nothing to fear. And I think that's something that we, you know, hey, listen, because what's going to happen is when our movement becomes bigger than their movement, then they're going to try to get on our coattails. Mm-hmm. And it's going to be too late, because you're already going to show yourself. Mm-hmm. You know, if you make calls and you can't get a legitimate answer that you have a right to know, then we have a problem.
I know, and it needs to be addressed. That's what I have to tell people when they come into the courts. Oh, you don't have a docket number. I can't give you that information. That's not public information. Okay, the public information, why is it so hard to get?
Right, if it's public.
If it's public.
Right.
Yeah.
And then you use the HIPAA law when you want to. Like, I have my son. I have another son. Like, he lost his father. Then he lost his brother. One of my sons is sitting in jail because he wants to do his own thing. So you got to suffer the consequence. My kids are not angels, but you know, just do your dirt. You got to do your time.
Sure.
So, regardless. I got one son in jail. I have my 20-year-old. He's just wandering aimlessly. He don't want to come home to me because I got too many rules for him to follow. He doesn't want, he stays house to house. He's like, my father's gone, my brother's in jail, my other one's dead, what do I have left? And then you have a probation officer who, oh, I can't talk to you because technically he's over 17, he's an adult. Just because you turn 17 don't make you an adult.
That's right.
But then when you can't find him, who do you call? You call me.
Right.
Oh, but now you can talk to me. Why don't you talk to me so I can help you help my child?
Right.
Where's that part? That part's out the door. Nobody uses that anymore. And that's the problem.
And that's the other thing that, you know, it's the children right now are another level of this that we have to start looking out for. And Sister Clarissa, I just want you to touch lightly on some of the things that we're doing through Legacy for the youth to get them to be able to come out from shutting down. In other words, giving them hope and life and be able to smile again. I just want you to touch on that a little bit so people can understand exactly what's going on here.
We are meeting them where they are. You know, we can't, you know, try to structure something that they're not going to be interested in. As we know, our children are,
it's okay.
Our kids are just as much as pain as we are. And they have a hard time with expressing it. Mm. At the ages that they are, they don't know how to express it. Mm. So one thing that we have been doing is we do expression through dance, through song, through music. And by the grace of God, he has truly opened doors that we have a teacher that comes over from Berkeley.
Wow.
And she's teaching us
piano,
kids and adults, and we're singing.
I heard, yeah, I heard you've been doing a little bit with that too.
Oh yeah, we're making music over there, and we're gonna have a show. We're gonna invite you.
Oh
down.
My
yeah,
God,
we're gonna have
a concert.
Oh yeah,
we're gonna sing a song to our loved ones and everybody's
in honor of our
kids. The rest of us will be playing instruments.
Yes.
Oh my goodness!
Yes.
And I took my daughter, and I was like, okay, this would be good therapy for her, because when I lost my husband, we went to an Epiphany program that helped us. And it was at the Epiphany School. Mm-hmm. And it had us all, children and adults, come together. And it was around loss. Everybody came together in a group, went around the room, said who they were and how they were feeling. Mm-hmm. We separated. Adults went one way. The children went another way. But they went with counselors that talked to them. And through whatever they played games or had conversation. When we all came back, the kids were able to speak about how they felt each time. It was different ways to help them build up how to talk about loss and how to accept it. Mm-hmm. And we need that for these children today in all categories.
That's
they
right.
don't have that right now.
That's
so
right.
Me taking my daughter to piano, I said, well, sir, I got to sit here for 2 hours. I might as well learn. My homework assignment was to go home and figure out the key of the song I'm going to play,
all
what
right.
it was in. I couldn't figure that out, but I can play Twinkle Twinkle Little Star.
Well,
all right.
You can build on that.
That's right. So you know you'll be leading worship, my sister.
All right.
Carrying a piano book around with me.
So beautiful.
That's beautiful. It's
making music.
If it wasn't for Legacy, I don't know where I'd be. Because I've tried the counseling thing, and I've gone, and I went into one counseling session, and I had some other children with me, and she said, she just started talking. I'm like, excuse me, is there some way the children can go? How does this work? Are you going to tell me who you are, what this is about? Like, you can't have a session with children in the room. And if we're going to have a session with children in the room, introduce yourself and say, hi, this is who I am.
Right,
like,
right.
Okay, about your son, it doesn't work like that.
Because, again, the children are, because a lot of times in our grief and our pain, you know, we lose that common point of relationship with our children, because how do we deal with a situation that nobody was ready for in the beginning?
Right.
That's right.
And, you know, it's, and I've come attached to your sons and your daughter, I mean, just like their mind, because, you know, I see the strength that you've given them just to be able to come through. But they're always at your side. But we have to continue to provide, because this is uncharted territory.
Mark, we ain't done yet with what we're doing.
All right, tell them what you're doing. That's what I'm talking about.
We just getting started.
We just getting started.
That's plus, also, we have crump dance.
That's right. That's
and
right.
These kids get up there and they just express themselves. Mary Ann has been a great supporter. Comes out on Mondays and they be getting it in.
And who's one of the integral part of that? Because he's actually one of the on air personalities.
Yes, Mark Green.
That's right.
And
oh, really?
Mark Salworth.
Yeah,
yes,
good.
They have been some great supporters, and Mark be there every Monday faithfully.
Very good.
We also have Gully Gospel and Rennick. Sorry, guys.
Yeah,
that's their crump name.
Right.
And I mean, they're awesome. They get with these kids, and these are Christian young men that comes with experience.
Amen.
They've been through bullying, they've been through homicide. And to see them, they get down with these kids. You know, it's phenomenal. These kids look forward to this
good.
Every month.
That's what I was gonna point out. That's
and
what
we
I wanna
pray.
That's right. That's
we do
right.
check in and we allow them to express themselves safely. And we're working on now bringing in a a counselor as well to be there on site if need be.
And one of the other, you know, because there's some, you know, and for anybody listening on tonight, again, you're listening to Boston Praise Radio and TV. This is the fifth night of our gun conference. I have to say, and I'm not taking anything from any of you all, but the funny thing is that there's some members here that still haven't been able to tell their stories. We actually have a member that has lost not one, but two sons. Now, that is, you know, I can't even begin to go down that road because I wish she was here. To tell her story, but
she's a powerful,
yes,
powerful woman of God.
Yes, see,
and I will say, Mark, now we have four women who have lost two sons. I mean, God is truly bringing them in, and I thank God for that.
Amen. I do too, because we need to come together. We need to unite as one body. God has greater works for us to do, and He's showing that every single week that we meet. I see growth when I see the room, you know, disperse. And it kind of feels good to still be here and know that that guy didn't come up tonight and tell, give us that look. Like,
well, Mark, they are people, so don't be dissing them.
No, I'm not. But what I'm saying is
the freedom of liberty.
We don't want to leave. That's what we don't want to shut
it
down.
What it is.
We gotta go.
That's exactly
what I was
thinking. Yeah.
They close at 8. We gotta be done. Yeah, but that's when it gets going. We get like 7:45. We start getting real.
Yeah. But see, and that's where we're at tonight. You know, it's been.
Walk about to get us kicked out.
Now we got to give Paul some love over there at the Geneva Ave Library.
All right.
And you know just for offering you the space and for you all to be able to do what you do.
And that was God. Let me tell you, through Legacy that was on, God has opened doors all around. Everything that we have been blessed with, it came with no cost. God done paid the price.
Amen.
And I thank Him for that.
Amen. We just joined by another guest here at our roundtable discussion tonight, Brother Hassan Smith, who is running for Suffolk County Sheriff's Department. We invited you tonight because you have, I have to keep it real with you. I don't want you to feel that you're going to be in the hot seat tonight because you're not, but I got to keep it real because I want people to understand the full spectrum of what we're doing. We're people of God. We ain't hide nothing.
Right.
But I invited you also because you've been on both sides of the fence.
Yes.
And I want you to, you know, first of all, again, tonight's topic, and I couldn't call you back because I was doing this, so you understand. Mm-hmm. But tonight's topic is, you know, we've been asking the question all week long, like, where are the illegal guns coming from? And tonight I wanted the families to share what they've been going through as a result of these guns coming in our community. And without going too far into the campaign mission of what you're doing, I want you to give your take on what you experienced, because you've been in the prisons, right, with some of these guys that have pulled the trigger. And also, you once were there yourself. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, first of all, let me thank Pastor Walls and Mark for allowing me to come here and address the audience. And my condolences go out to everyone in this room.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
I was a juvenile at the time. I was 15. And Boston had its highest rate of homicides amongst juveniles. It was over 100 and something murders that year in Boston. And unfortunately, I fell victim to one of those murders. I shot a 21-year-old male. And he died as a result of me shooting him. And I didn't go to prison, though. I went to the Department of Youth Services. They felt that I would be best served by the Department of Youth Services. And praise God, it worked out, because I'm here today. And during that period while I was there, there was a lot of things that I was booking. Like, I didn't like white people. You know, I thought I was justified not liking them. But as I got older, I began to realize that, listen, you can't judge a whole organization for the actions of a few. Mm. My mother was very, very disciplined as far as working with the Department of Youth Services and making sure that I had the right type of treatment and programs. So when I do come back to Boston, I'll be able to mix into the Boston crowd. So I spent 2 years in a secure for treatment facility. And the third year I spent in a foster home, which was out in Northampton, Mass. I went to high school out there, finished my last year of high school, then I came back to Boston and did some college. After that, I was supposed to be like a poster boy for the Department of Youth Services. And so while I was in school and doing the right thing, some officials came to me and they said, well, maybe you should get your juvenile record sealed. So I said, okay, well, how do I go about doing that? Mm. And they told me, so because a lot of people think that the juvenile record is just automatically sealed, and it's not automatically sealed. So I went and I asked the Commissioner of Probation to seal my juvenile record. And they said, we will, but you have to write a 2-page letter stating why you want it sealed. You have to have some credible references backing you up. So once that happened, it was sealed. Then I was able to apply for a job at a major law enforcement agency. And I was shocked. I didn't think I would get the job, but I was shocked when they finally, because they did an intensive investigation. They came by my house. They watched me. They talked to people that knew me, you know, and everything went according to schedule. And I received a job with the Suffolk County Sheriff's Department as an officer of the law. And I was in shock and awe when they sent me to the firing range to teach me how to shoot a gun.
Wow.
So I carried a gun for 10 years legally with no incidents. After that, I began to notice the struggles of people coming through the prison system. It's a revolving door. So I tried to make some changes while I was there as an officer, but I seen they didn't want to hear that. They didn't want to hear it from me anyway. So then I said, well, the best thing for me to do would be to run for office then, so that I can help with this situation, so that our kids are not getting out of prison and coming back, getting out of prison then coming back, or getting out of prison disturbing the communities again. Mm-hmm. And I came up with some people might call it extreme, but I call it just doing the right thing. We need to have mandated education in the prison systems. I'm not just talking about academic education. I'm talking about social education,
right.
Yeah. Economic education, mm-hmm. because it doesn't make no sense for somebody to have a job if they can't keep it. It doesn't make no sense for somebody to have housing if they can't keep it. And I love what you just said about, you know, not talking to your child because your child's 17. Listen, mm-mm. I raised my daughter by myself. She's 21 years old. She's in college. She's a third year in college now. And I had to go through mm-hmm. hell and back with her when she was 15, 16, start failing her rules. But I refused to let anybody come out and tell me how I was going to raise my kids. Right. So I had a lot of Boston police officer friends that came by my house. This one agency contacted me, told me I was wrong for doing that. I just hung up on them because I had to go down to the probation department. I took out a shins on my daughter, which is child needed services, because I told her I was not playing that. I know what I've been through in the streets, and I didn't want to see my daughter go through that same mess. So when I went down there, the probation officer talking to me about her boyfriend. And I'm saying to myself, we're not here for that. And then I said to her, listen, we're not here for that. We're here because she's being disrespectful at home and she's not following the rules and regulations at school. And I don't want to talk about her boyfriend. She said, right. Well, you could talk to the judge. I said, well, fine, we'll talk to the judge.
So, you know, again, because you've been on both sides of the fence,
right.
and I thought that was key with you. What do you see right now going on in our community with the accessibility of these guns coming into our community?
First of all, I see this, lack of education. Second of all, I noticed that because this country was made off of money, what we need to do is put pressure on these politicians to tell them, listen, go after these gun factories. Let them know if your gun gets found on such and such and such and such a murder, well, you're going to get fined. And when money talks, what do they say?
People listen.
Right. When you start hitting people in the pockets, then they'll start doing something about it. And that's what I've said many, many times before. You know, I don't know who has been listening to me, but I seriously believe if we stop finding these gun manufacturers and things like that, this stuff will stop. This stuff will cease. And I'm not talking about no $100 fine. I'm talking about thousands and thousands, even a million if a life is gone, you know, because your gun ended up somewhere it had no business being.
Because then they'll take more care and precaution in who they sell it to.
Right.
Amen. Amen.
You know what I mean?
Right. Right.
Now, they don't care. If you got the money, you got yours.
Right.
Right. Right.
But
right.
Wasn't the NRA successful in a sense,
covering themselves.
Covering their interests and not being, and those gun factories not being held sued liable. Or held accountable.
Well,
weren't they successful?
Yeah, they were, you know, and you know why they're successful? Because they spread a lot of money on Capitol Hill. Okay, they spent, they spread a lot, and when I say a lot, I'm talking taking folks out to $1,000 lunches and giving them an envelope to say, hey, listen, you know, that, that word you hear, lobbyist, that's right. Just a legal way of money laundering, if you ask me, for your cause. I mean, seriously, because, I mean, we always ask the question, when is it going to be enough? Okay, after the 20 kids in Newtown, and you're still telling me we're still having a problem getting this gun legislation passed? It should have been a no-brainer walk in the park.
Right. Well, and so there, again, it lies the question, so what is the recourse that we have to combat against that type of...
You repeal that law, and then you file something in place of it.
Okay, so again, I think, again...
It's an urgent cause because the first thing is they say that we can't stand together. We have to unify.
Right.
We have to unify. I have in this room, there's about 2, 4, 6, 8. There's 12 people here who have suffered a loss in just one small area of this world right now. Imagine the folks in Chicago listening in over a GMAT radio. They had over 500 and some odd murders last year of our young people. Okay, we're not talking, that's just Chicago. We're not talking about Detroit. We're not talking about Atlanta. We're not talking about DC, Baltimore, LA. We need to get families together on a massive scale. Like, you know, it has to be to the point that we have to come together and make our voices heard very, very loud. Like you said, the dog ain't big, but the bite is what you're worried about.
Right, right.
And that's what we have to do. We have to prepare a proper enough bite that they're gonna take notice. And because right now what they're banking on is that we can't come together with the means and the ways to defeat that. Right. Because like Charleston Heston, oh, you got to cry this from my cold, dead hands. But tell me, why do you need that living here? You understand? Why do you need to send me, like the guy that shot a bear in wherever it was. Okay, you know, he's baiting the bear. I mean, that just tells you what the process is.
But you see that? He shot a bear and they're ready to hang him. An officer shot my son and I don't even get a name.
See,
go figure.
Right. You're right. You're right. You're absolutely right.
Come on. Where is the priority?
Right.
My son is not an animal. He's a human, and I need some answers
right.
from the authority that I work with and for.
And it should be. It should be. And it
I
should
shouldn't
be
have
forthright.
To wait a year.
That's right. Amen.
I shouldn't have to wait for them to cover up.
Amen. And also, I want to. We were talking about you earlier. I want to welcome you. First of all, I want to congratulate you on the play tonight. I'm sorry I couldn't come over, but as you see, we had it on and popping over here. Introduce yourself and tell them a little bit. We talked about Auntie Nat's Village, but Auntie Nat is now here. So break it on down. It's your time. We're gonna put you right on, my sister.
Okay. So, first of all, good evening.
Good evening. Good evening. So good to see
my
you.
Name is Natalie. And I had a son. His name's Damien. He was murdered on the streets of Boston in 07. He was a gentleman that was found in Forest Hill Cemetery. And so the day the officers, the detectives came and met me at my mom's house to tell me that my son had been murdered, my first thought was, let go and let God. I didn't want any revenge. You know, from the family. And then my heart went out to the other side of the family, the mother, the father. I often wondered how are the parents going to feel when they find out that your child pulled the trigger, regardless to whose child it was. Mm. You know, I'm quite sure you didn't raise him like that. You know, so that allowed me to not want to be angry. And that's what I thrive on, not being angry. I buried myself into my job. And I really forgot that I had other children.
Listen, I'm mad.
And when my job closed down, I went home. And I couldn't put the key in the door. Because it hit me. Oh God, you got other children behind that door. And when I was able to put that key in that door and go in that house, thank you. I told my kids how sorry I was. And I told myself that not another day would I not do something? I needed a plan. It took 5 years. 5 years today. A year ago, I met Clarissa. I just did a show at Great Hall. And that's where I met Clarissa at. And so I've met her a year ago. But in that process, before I met Clarissa, a few years before that, my son used to come home and he used to always talk about this boy at school from the Dearborn named Stephen. And one day my son came home and he was in his room. And when I tell you, he destroyed his room. I went in there, I said, Damien, Kevin, what is going on? He said, Mommy, my friend got killed. I said, your friend? He said, yeah, Stephen. I said, Stephen, oh my God. So he was, when I tell you my son was angry, I had to go to the courts. I had to put a chins on my child. My son didn't want to leave the house. And he was just so angry, so, so angry. And I felt so bad, and I prayed and I prayed and I said, God, please help me find a solution. And he did. He brought me Auntie Nat's Village. So what the Village is it's an organization that I do at the Eggleston Square Library every Saturday from 12 to 2. So I bring children in that's had homicide in their lives and trauma. I try to get the parents to come in with them because it's not a babysitting service. I try to get the parents to come in with them. Let's have a roundtable discussion. I need to know how the children are feeling. I need to know what the parent is feeling. Sometimes the parents don't know what's going on because I experienced that. I worked, I buried myself into my job. So I didn't know what my kids were thinking. I didn't know how they felt. The village I grew up in, you went to church. You went to your grandparents' house every weekend and you knew that's where you was going and you was happy. You know, and grandma made jello with food in the bottom of it and Zara.
Yeah, talk about it. Look at Pastor Wall, he's rubbing his stomach. Like,
I didn't like it though.
Right. But that's what you
had. That's what you had. You
know? That's right.
And you went to church and then you went downstairs and you ate as a family in the church.
Family.
And on Sunday, you were so happy to get back home and tell your parents what you did at grandma's house. You look over to your left or your right. Hi, how you doing? Can I help you bring your bags in? Mm-hmm. You had a red wagon, and you went up to that store, and whoever's mother came out that door, you put them bags in that wagon, and you pulled it home. And those are the things that I'm trying to get village. Our young kids to instill
village
in them.
Mentality.
The Bible.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know why, for some reason, the devil is at me. But I'm not going to let him win.
I think this is the devil's week.
The parents, Clarissa, every week. I know Legacy has a lot of things going on in the mother's work. So Saturday, you know, some of them are tired. But Clarissa will grab them kids up and she bring them to Auntie Nat's Village if I don't have them. But just the kids she bring in. But I refuse to not have Auntie Nat's Village. I refuse to. I have a plan. I have it posted on Facebook, Auntie Nat's Village. I also have an agenda on there, learn how to love your neighbor. So what the children in the village are going to be doing is we are going to have people sign in if you need your yard raked. So the children will come in and they will rake that yard. And in return, some of the mothers from Legacy and the mothers that come into the village with their children will have a grill going. So the kids can have a hot dog. It's not about money. Mm. If they save up enough money, they're going to buy a gun. Not from the village, you won't. You're going to get a hot dog, you're going to get a juice, a fruit cup, we're going to sit, we're going to merge, we're going to exchange numbers, and they're going to be children.
Right.
And we are going to be the adults that are going to be responsible for that. We are going to serve these senior citizen buildings with ice water. We are going to spend time with them. Have a hot dog day. There's a lot of senior citizens that are lonely, that have no one, but they want children to talk to, to tell their story back in the day. I have somebody coming in as of next month, two Saturdays out of a month. She's a young woman. Two Saturdays out of a month, she's going to do a children Bible story. But if we don't get the children back into the church, we are really going to lose.
And again, and that's where I'm coming from about us coming together. We have to have a, you know, a word that I always hear Pastor Wall use is that he holds his congregation accountable. And we have to hold each other accountable in support. Because this is a massive effort of all of us coming together. A chain has to be formed. But I'm not talking about that little $1.99 chain. I'm talking the chain that holds a battleship in the water. Those big chains. You've seen them, right? The links are like this thick. I mean, that's what we have to do. We have to come together because I'm going to tell you right now, it's going to start with us. That's where it's going to start. It's not going to start up on Capitol Hill. It's going to start with us going out here and making enough noise and enough bite that they understand that the people out here in this community can't realize that this can't happen here anymore. And I say that because back in the day, the church was the focal point of the community, period. If somebody came in running for office, they went to the main church and got permission from the pastor before they went into the community. Now they don't even go to the church. They only stop in just to show their face because they know, yeah, that's it. But before, the church was the integral part in the community where if anything went on, the church had either a say-so in it or the church brought the actions of it. And if somebody's house burned down, it was the pastor that would come there with the blankets, never mind the Red Cross. And that's what we have to get back to. We have to get back to that. We often made the cry about, you know, it takes a village to raise a child. And Auntie Nat's village was birthed. It was already coming up, but that was, I guess, the last drop of water after the roots went out, and now it came out through the ground. And again, I say that this is what we have to do.
Right.
You understand? We have enough strength in us because we're all around this mic tonight. We are all sharing. And this is what it's about. We have to do this. It's not going to come from any, listen, they got money up on Capitol Hill that's going to battle us for every, but they can't, that money can't stop us from going out here, going to a park and making some noise down at the park and blessing some people down at that park and letting the people know that, hey, listen, we're not going away. And that's something I saw from Pastor Wall. He's like, I'm not going away until you move. And now it's done. And the funny thing is, you know, you throw a pebble into the ocean, that ripple effect. Yeah, but that ripple could turn into a tsunami if we do it right. That's all I'm saying is that we have to come together. And we have to, each one of us has a gift.
Of course.
And that gift is melded into that chain. And that chain's going to be unbreakable.
Right.
Unbreakable.
It don't take a whole lot. You know, a lot of us grew up earlier as children just singing probably this hymn that this little light of mine.
That's yes. Right.
I'm going to let it shine.
Amen.
With your light, like what you were saying, your light, right. Our light, we can set this world ablaze.
Amen.
With just your light. But when we all come together, there's the inferno. So it don't take a whole lot.
And we have to keep God first. It's right. Not about individual. You said a key thing. It's not about money. Because I've seen us do so much with very little money. Every Thursday, Sister Clarissa, we have a little chew down, chew and chat. You know, she brings, I don't care if it's sandwiches or something, but we're not being regulated by anybody's right. Grant money. We're being regulated by God. And that's where we're at right now. And we need to come together. Again, I want to thank Hassan for coming through tonight. Because, you know, again, I wanted his story to be told because he's been on both sides of the fence. But I like what God is doing in his life now. As opposed to, he could have been that statistic that's still locked up behind the bars right now without a chance. But he came out and he made an example. And he's also one of those people that, like he said, he's raising a daughter on his own. And we have to turn to each other. We are the family that we need. We have God as our Father. And if we are all one body with many members. And I'm saying that backwards, I know. But
no, that's good.
But you understand where I'm coming from, right?
I understand it perfectly.
Right. So this is the hand, and all the fingers come together. This is the attitude that we have to have in order for us to go forward. We're targeting on our youth. We're targeting on the families. We're targeting on how to do this together.
Right.
And that's what's most important. You want to say something?
Yes, I just wanted to respond to her question about how do we go about doing it. It's something what I do when I go around talking about my political run. People always say, well, you need this man, you need this person to support you. He's political. I said, no, I don't. What I need the people. I need the people to understand that we in this room, we are the majority. But as long as we don't vote, then we will continue to be the minority. We are the majority. So it's up to us to tell our people that, tell them, listen, we got to stand up for what's right, and we got to do what's right. I'm not saying that I even have to be the chair, but somebody needs to be in there that's doing the job. Somebody needs to be in there that's doing the job. And that's what I want. And that's what I want from my local representatives. That's what I want from my federal representatives. I want them to understand. I just don't want them to show up at meetings and talk about things that really don't have nothing to do with us. And I say, if we don't get involved in the cycle, people are going to continue to come in our neighborhoods and pass rules and regulations on our neighborhoods that have nothing to do with us.
Right.
Nothing to do with us. That's why we need to get involved. We need to do right. our homework on people. Stop voting for free people because they're
Democrats or they're
Republicans.
Yeah. Know what you're voting
nice
for.
Looking, right.
Amen.
You know, we have to know about that person. And if that person's going to do the job, and guess what? If they don't do the job, we get them out of there for the next time.
And I think that's why the village is so important.
Right.
Because for those that don't understand,
mm-hmm.
you know, if they just allow themselves to be there and spend time with their children and engage with other parents that are there, they can learn a lot from it. I mean, there's a lot of young girls out here, and I feel like, they add to the guns. Because they'll get this guy, and he'll say, hey, baby, you know, listen, you got a clean record. You know, come on, let's go up to New Hampshire. And you purchase a gun.
Strong.
You know, and that's what they do.
We must create some preventive measures. And I wanted to go ahead, Pastor.
Yeah, Sister Natalie is bringing a great point in, and that was something that was discussed earlier. I think the beginning of the conference started with Nancy Robinson of Citizens for Safety. And Nancy Robinson was the one that prompted that question, where did the gun come from? And as a result of prompting that question, some of the answers that came from that was one of the sources of the guns that are trafficked into our urban communities is through straw purchasing. And then another answer to that straw purchasing was that, unfortunately, our women are being exploited to be the straw purchasers because many of them...
The mules, to sort of speak.
And they have the clean record and could perhaps pass a background check, and so they're being used to do that. Both, so they're being used as straw purchases. Those that are old enough to go and purchase a gun, but even as you say, Sister Natalie, some of our younger teenage girls are being used to hold the guns and hide the guns.
Amen.
And so it's important for us to, educate, to raise that awareness, and help our young people realize that. You know, sometimes you might think that you're helping someone out, or you're being, you know, loyal,
well,
or you're
the down for the cause.
Yeah. But the consequence of that choice that you're making at the end of that is somebody's life. That someone's life is either going to be harmed or ultimately they're going to be murdered. And you'll be contributing to that. And I don't think that folks think about that to that extent, and
we have to
be there to train our children and to teach them that. I love this Auntie Nat's Village, and I love that, you know, it was sparked by, we often say, it takes a village to raise a child. And lately I've been sharing, not only does it take a village to raise a child, but it takes a village to save lives.
That's right,
and so,
amen.
And,
amen.
And while we are... we are our desire and our goal is to hold accountable those elected officials that we've put in office, both locally and federally, and at the state level, all three levels. So it's still, we still have to hold accountable. And so in terms of this, the gun conference or the gun conversation that we're having, we still, while we're holding them accountable to do their part, to really think about and the common sense safety measures that need to be in place, as it was said, we have to hold ourselves accountable as well on what we're doing on the ground to make sure that we're, you know, educating and speaking to our young people, our parents, all of us. You know, we all play a part in this. Just recently, I had an opportunity to participate in what they call, it's like a ceasefire, where there's, you know, some young men that are re-entering into the community, and they, you know, bring them to the court and sit down, and they have people talk to them about, you know, in a sense, you know, going straight and narrow, so to speak, you know, make sure you're doing the right thing so that you don't end up back, you know, in the system. And they have these different ones come in to talk, and they have some folks that are resource people to provide job training and education, GED, things like that. But they asked, you know, for a survivor to come in and to speak, and I was asked to come in and to share. And I've done this before, and I always, when I do this, my concern is when you're sharing your hurt and your pain to someone, I'm a person who likes to dialogue. Right, like, right. I know it's important perhaps for me to share with you, share my pain, but I want to hear your pain. So when I go and I share with these, and usually it's young men in the room, the way that it's set up, they don't have it so that you can really dialogue with them. So it's really, you're just talking, you're kind of talking at these young men. But, you know, sharing the story, and I, in my sharing this past week with these young men, I was talking about, you know, going back over even saying to them, it's hard for me to comprehend that, that people are coming to a place or getting so angry that they have no value for life.
Right.
And that you can just take another person's life like that. I was sharing that when I was brought up, we were taught to love your neighbor.
That's right.
You said and we have to, and we can't lose, you know,
sight.
And that teaching that we had when we were coming up.
Right.
And we in a sense, have lost, that we've been allowed certain things that have, certain things happening in our society to strip away that value system.
Right.
You know, and so, you know, and so when we wonder why our children act the way that they're acting, the structures have been less than stripped. Mm-hmm. You know, when we were going to school, you had to dress a particular way. You might have left the house. You left the house one way, and you might have changed it, school. You know, or changed it when you left the house. But even when you got to
home,
even when you got to school, they would say, "Oh no, you put your stuff," and then you would change after school, whatever. But there were structures.
Yes.
That stuff has, you know, when I look at some of the folks going to the courthouse. You go to the courthouse, and there was a time when you didn't go like that, right?
Yes.
You didn't go. So,
so they don't get surrendered.
So this stuff is happening on the adult watch.
Right.
This stuff is happening. So it's on us as adults. Right. Where do we go? How do we allow this to even happen to the point that it's happening?
And that's the thing. Each one has to reach one. We definitely have to start passing on, because, you know, we've lost a whole generation of morals and ethics after, you know, the cocaine epidemic came out in our community, and a lot of these kids are running around and they're angry because they're prodigies of what, you know, went on during that time a few years ago. And, you know, we got to wrap this up. And, I personally, because this makes great for, you know, the next phase of what we're going to do and how we're going to get together. You know, we definitely have to start passing on of the old values of what we were taught and instilled. And even if the child is not ours, we need to share wisdom with them. We have to teach our young men to pull their pants up. You know, I'm tired of seeing them on the bus, you know, acting like they ain't got, you know, what do you understand what it really means? We really have to share that knowledge. Hosea 4:6, for my people will be destroyed for the lack of knowledge. And we have to start sharing that knowledge with our youth if they're going to have a chance to really, you know, come through this thing. Because when we start making some noise, we got to offer them a platform on where to go.
And see, that's what when you bring up the Hosea, you know, it's somebody's fault. It's somebody's fault. And during that time, it was the preacher, it was the pastors, it was the priests to responsibility to teach. And because the people are destroyed for lack of knowledge, somebody's fault. Somebody's at fault here. Amen. You can't blame a person that don't know. But if somebody has to teach them, reach them, each.
Thank you. You know, a lot of times, I'm sorry.
That's all right, go ahead.
A lot of times they say today, oh, where's the father? I grew up with 7 brothers and sisters, and my dad was not there. But my mom did a hell of a job. She did a hell of a job. You know, so it's, I don't really cling to that when they say, oh, the man is missing. You know, you have to take time with your children. You have to, what I do, open up the closet, lift up the mattress, pull the dresser drawers out, run my hand up there. I done been fooled once, you know? And I run through my house.
That's homeland. That's homeland security.
You know something? They can't always use that because my children came from a two-parent home.
Exactly.
So they can't, you can't.
Right, right.
Every circumstance is different. I had the husband at there. I did the standards that they asked for. My son's not here. He wasn't a bad kid. He got into a few scrapes. He did his time. He come home. He wants to start his life over. They said, you go to jail. You come out. Re-entry into the world. So he's supposed to be re-entered into this world as this new civilian. Correction. Let him be that. So why are you all following him? Right. Why is he real following him? You know, he's trying to do the right thing. He's signing up for school. You got police officers following him. And it's not because of my son. It's because of the company he kept, his friends. Right. My son was loyal to a fault. His friends aren't all that good. But who are you to say you can't hang with him because it doesn't make my person, that doesn't make my son who, you know what I'm trying to say?
Yep, exactly.
You have to judge an individual on their own merits.
Amen. I want to thank everybody in this room. I want to thank Brother Hassan, I the Odoms, I got nothing but elevated love for you all. And we hope that you would stop in on one of our Thursday sessions down at the library on Geneva Ave, just to stop in sometime and fellowship with us. Of course, Legacy Lives On. This is our annual meeting night. You can meet with us every Thursday at the Grove Hall Library from 6 to 8 on Thursdays, every Thursday. It was every other Thursday, but we do it every Thursday because some of us need it every week. Auntie Nat's Village goes on every Saturday at the Eggleston Square Library from 12 to 2. Right? Is it 12 to 2? All right. And we will definitely keep you. You have a website. Does anybody have the website information? I know it's www.legacy.com. There you go. Miss Ray got her card right there. I want to read that. And Pastor Odom, I would love for you to close us in prayer. I wanted to open in prayer, but it didn't roll like that. But I know I want us to close in prayer. If anybody wants to contact Legacy Lives On, it's www.legacyliveson.org. Please, if you know anyone who's lost a loved one to homicide in our city, we want you to contact, we want you to reach out, we want you to know that there's a platform. And this will be aired again Friday at 7 p.m. It'll be aired again here on Boston Praise Radio and TV. We want to thank you all again. It was just a move of God to see what he's doing. I don't have to look in the sky for miracles. I look in this room and see nothing but miracles. And Pastor Wall, I want to thank you for putting Boston Praise Radio out there, because, you know, we're dealing with the issues no one else wants to deal with. The media, if it doesn't give them good ratings, they don't want to talk about it and they don't want to deal with it. But these are things that we live. And I want to thank you for putting Boston Praise Radio on the forefront to take this issue on head on. Even though they told us not to do it, we're still going to do it because we God's people. Amen. So again, I want to thank you all. Pastor Odom, could you close us in prayer?
Sure.
Please.
Let's bow our head. Father, we thank you once again for yet another day that you have allowed us to see. We thank you, God, for sunshine. We thank you for rain. You let us know that in everything that we should give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning us. God, each and every one of us that are here tonight, we have shared our heart. You heard the pain. You've heard our anger. You heard our bitterness. You heard our frustration. Yes, yes. God, you even let us know in your word that you let us know that to be angry, but sin not. So that scripture alone validates our anger. But you let us know to sin not. For don't let the sun go down on our wrath, or we'll be just as guilty as those that have harmed us. So God, it's all right for us to share our heart. And even us, with some of us, we even have some questions, oh God. Yes. But God, we know that even Jesus had questions when he was on his way to the cross to redeem men back to redeem men to you, Lord God. So we pray that you would continue to hear what our hearts have shared on tonight. And God, you make some sense of it, for we really are here even tonight. Some of us, we really just don't understand, but we know that one day we'll understand it better. Mm-hmm. By and by, when the morning comes, God, you even let us know our tears are temporary release of the pain and the sorrow and the grief, but one day that we won't have to cry anymore. Because we know that you will wipe all our tears away. So God, we pray that your spirit would continue to hover around us, be a fence all around us, protect us even as we go. God, we pray that even the words that our mouth and the meditations of our heart, that they would be accepted in your sight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. I want to leave you with Marvin Sapp, My Testimony. We thank you once again for joining us right here on Boston Praise Radio and TV. This is the fifth night of Where Do the Illegal Guns Come From? Peace, love, and blessings to all.